To start with, probably you guys, most of you are aware, you know what Info Edge is. I work for this company which the parent name of the company is Info Edge Limited. Most of you should be aware what are the different businesses we are in. We are a consumer internet company, by and large known for the flagship brand. Most of you are aware. What's a flagship brand name? Naukri.com. Yeah. So we have operations in India, we have operations outside India, which is Naukri Gulf. We have a business which is in real estate space, which is 99acres.com. Most of you should be aware of it. We are in the space of matrimony. You know, we have a business called Jivan Sati, which runs the matrimony business. And Siksha.com, by and large, you guys should be aware, we are in the education space. We have invested in many other consumer internet companies, be it as a Metro, be it Policy Bazaar, Maidala, Merit Nation, and so on and so forth. We've been investing on a lot of you know technology-based startups. So that's what the background of the organization is. And most of you here should have been registered as far as Naukri.com is concerned. Yeah. So that makes my job easy. What do you guys want from me? You know, I've given you a background of the organization and what brings you here, what is it you want from me, then probably we can set the context that we can take the conversation from there on. Anything in specific you guys want me to talk about here? Otherwise, we can go about, the major gap in terms of recruitment. A lot of corporates are looking at hiring people. In fact, I had posted an article, which is a metal article, from Economic Times, that the IIMs and IITs, are getting a higher salary, which is as high as 137% IITs versus a normal engineer, versus 127%, if I'm not wrong, as far as IIMs are concerned, from a normal graduate. This is a classic example of the dearth of talent in the market. If we can touch upon the real-time problems in terms of what is the difficulty as an organization. Despite running a big portal called Naukri.com, we have close to about 57 million resumes with us. But how do we go about recruiting our own resources? I can touch upon that if that is of some excitement to you guys. If that will sort of interest you guys. Otherwise, we've been hiring people right from an IIM to a, and I frequent this campus for recruitment as well. We can talk about what is it as an organization, as a recruiter, we look forward in candidates like you. So we can touch upon that, the real-time problems. So where is the gap? The student comes with an expectation that, okay, I've now, onboarded, you guys are onboarded with NDIM. 2 years from now, you'll be graduating from NDIM and then you'll be expected to be placed elsewhere, somewhere, with an expectation. Is it the responsibility of the institution or is it the responsibility of the resource? We can even touch upon that. I was there in MDI a couple of weeks back. We had an interesting conversation with the director. Even MDI, he was mentioning that the challenge of the institution is that the students come with an expectation that it's an ROI game. I preferred MDI because MDI had a better placement track. I preferred this institution. We hired somebody from IIM Samarpur last week. They put the responsibility conveniently on the institution. So we can touch upon that if that is of interest. If that would sort of interest you guys. I have so many other things, but what would interest you? What is that you want to know from me? I have very little experience, just 21 years of experience. So, if that experience can actually help you take something away from this room, because I want to keep it a little simple, less intense, that there are some takeaways that, you can actually use it on a daily basis, Or I can talk about a couple of big things which, as an organization, which we face some crisis in the organization in terms of scale-up, and how did we go about fixing them? Which topics sort of excites you? Then probably we can start from there. Anybody from the crowd? Sangeeta ma'am, you want to point in?
They should
want to know how they can increase their employability level, because they have
a
conceptual, you know, thing in their head
that
only books are going to take them everywhere.
Okay.
So we can
touch upon
that, employability factor.
Is that something which will excite you guys?
Yes.
How to increase your employability quotient?
Yes.
Yeah. We were there, you know, myself and a couple of my senior colleagues, you know, we had visited IIM Ahmedabad for hiring a couple of product managers. The process is the same, you know, be it, you know, we go to an institution which is a premium based school, tier 1, tier 2, the process remains the same. So, you know, the notion which I want to break here is that I am an MBA, I am a PhDM, or I am from IIM, or I am from an NDIM is not going to qualify you for a job. So that's the first thing which I want to break the notion. Yeah, you know, the placement cell, the admission cell will sort of share you with a JD, and whichever JD is sort of appealing to you, you pick up those JDs and then appear in for an interview. So it so happened that there are few candidates who picked up this JD of what we shared with IIM Ahmedabad, and the process was not like that. Okay, I think you are from IIM Ahmedabad, so you are hired. It did not happen like that. The tag of IIMA is not going to qualify you to get a job in InfoEdge. There is a process which was followed. The process is by and large, there is an expectation from the organization in terms of the skill sets a resource has to bring to the table. We have identified certain skill sets that a product manager has to bring to the table. You know, be it, research about products, be it, how this product, is going to help the business to grow. How can I even create a world-class product that is differentiating the platform or the business? There are certain prerequisites as far as the role is concerned, and then the conversation is started with the resource, with the tag, with the IIT IIM tag, he comes and then attends this session, and then unless he meets the skill set which is a prerequisite, then somebody is already yawning. Okay. We'll keep it simple. Yeah, I know. So, then is when, so we eventually ended up meeting some 8 resources and zeroed in on somebody who we thought probably will be able to take up the responsibility. We made an offer. The resource was super excited. The offer was, on par with the industry. The resource came to the organization, was given a responsibility of, okay, I think, let's do a seasoning, what we call as a seasoning. You guys do an internship, which is a part of your seasoning. The resource was given a responsibility in terms of doing certain things from the product perspective. 3 months, 4 months, 5th month, the resource had to leave. It is the organization which resource was super excited about. 6 months back, he had to go through a lot of process, which is in terms of, identifying the right skill set. The organization identified this is the skill set what I want. This is the skill set which the resource brought to the table. And then the resource was given the opportunity which he or she wanted to, that's what, they wanted to have. They got the job with the right organization. Where do you think was the gap in terms of, why the resource had to part ways? What could have been a gap? This would, to an extent, will solve the quotient of your employability. It will increase the chances of your employability. I do this with almost every institution, every interns I do this. Every new hired resources, the part of the induction program touches upon this. Where do you think was the gap? Anything?
Practical knowledge about how to attend this certain problem.
Fantastic. What else?
Just
chances are that the things that he brought to the table were just theoretical knowledge.
Absolutely.
But when the same thing was applied in practical knowledge, there was a huge difference.
Fantastic. Anybody else want to contribute? Okay, I'll not take too much. Haji. Okay. Possible? Possible? So, before I give you an answer, you know, people who had understood the BFSI industry, you know, if anybody has a bank account, the first thing which has been told to you is, anybody knows what is KYC?
No.
Fantastic. That's a good participation. So, I think most of you in this room, if in case I come and talk to you about what is the features of an iPhone 10 or probably a OnePlus 6, the cost to the features, I think most of you should be aware. I think everybody in this room should be a gadget freak, right? Yeah, right? Most of you will have a bucket list in terms of which are all the destinations you should go during your, you know, where to go, what to do. Most of you will be aware in terms of a lot of things, a lot of features, a lot of benefits. But the biggest gap, what I've seen, you know, this is my personal viewpoint and with the limited experience what I have and the limited of exposure what I have. What I've seen is a candidate or an aspirant doesn't know much about himself, doesn't know much about his skill set, doesn't know what he wants. And this want is by and large driven by somebody else, you know, it's highly influenced by somebody else. You know, I want to go to an IIM, yeah, I will also go to an IIM. You know, if at all you guys have seen the Siksha's advertisement sometime back, the commercial, our caption is, stop following and start exploring. So where I'm even coming from is most of the want, most of the need is driven by somebody else. Papa ne bola, chacha ne bola, dost ne. That's what the needs you should be, one should be very, very clear in terms of who I am. What is it I bring to the table? What are my skill sets? When I can do a complete analysis of what is an iPhone 10 versus an iPhone versus a OnePlus 6, I should be able to know what is it I want, who am I actually, you should do a thorough SWOT is a, you know, very understatement, but you should know what are your strengths, what are your challenges, what can actually unsettle you, because if people understand what can actually unsettle you in an organization, then the attrition rate, which is the boiling issue of any organization, the boiling issue of any organization is human capital. There are just two things, you know, as far as the industry is concerned. You have to have a good product, two, you have to have good people. These are the two important ingredients as far as an organization is concerned. So if in case somebody is able to know what can actually unsettle me in an organization, the attrition rate is handled. So where am I even coming from is, to give you an answer of the question which I asked, is there was a skill set which was demanded and there was a skill set which was brought to the table. So there was no much of a gap. There was a prerequisite as far as an educational background is concerned, because we were very particular that it has to be an IIT IIM who has to be a product manager. It was met. There are a couple of more things which were actually assessed, you know, as an organization. This is something which is very, very important. As a recruiter, I look forward for these things, you know, which can also increase your employability. Quotient is that, what's your attitude? Now, attitude, how does it even matter to an organization which is going to hire me? It's very important. How do you approach your life? How do you approach your career? How do you approach a crisis? How do you approach challenges? How do you approach you know, a success. You know, it all depends upon your attitude. That's an important thing which has to be demonstrated to an organization. Very important. Second thing is what we actually look forward with certain, you know, resources is that, you know, we wanted to understand what's their thought process. Something interesting? Something interesting in the bag? What's the thought process? What is the thought process of a resource? You know, how deep can you go in terms of, you know, in a conversation with an interviewer, with a recruiter? How deep? It is not that I'm being told as far as a JD is concerned and I'm prepared as far as JD is concerned and there is somebody who's part of the finishing school will come and teach me as to how to behave in an interview. That's not going to, you know, get you higher employability. It's to do with you. Third aspect, what we actually look forward from the resource was the groomability, whether the resource comes across as groomable, whether you know, he or she has that acceptance towards change, acceptance towards adaptability, whether the change is going to help the student in terms of grooming herself or himself in the organization. Beside all that, the resource did not know what he wanted. He just wanted a good job, fancy salary, swanky office, and then 3 months, 4 months, fifth month he realized that this is not what I want to do, because the want was driven by somebody else. He realized that this is not something which is going to help me in terms of, you know, upskilling myself for a career, and hence he parted ways. You guys are able to relate this by any chance? Less of S, more of S. Is, yeah? So what is the takeaway as far as, you know, this session is concerned? What should be your first takeaway?
To know us.
You should know you thoroughly in and out. You should know you thoroughly in and out what you want. What do you want? And the want has to come from you. You should know what will appeal to you. What will make you adapt to a situation. What changes do you think you will be able to accept? What can unsettle you? That's what we call in a SWOT. It's not a threat. It's not that somebody, insecurity of a job is going to be a threat. It's your own attitude in terms of handling a crisis would have made you unsettle the job, and then you start disliking the job. All that what you wanted to crack is get into this organization, and 1 month down the line, you know, you might start disliking the organization, because these are things which people have not anticipated. And we were actually having a chat, you know, with some of your professors, and this is what I hear from most of the institutions as recruiters. People's expectations are slightly different. Is that so with you guys? Is that so with you guys? I'm a PGDM MBA graduate now. I will only get into a consulting job. You know, I will only go to a Deloitte, or I will only go to a BCG, or I will only go to a KPMG. Because I've seen this with most of the organizations. And unfortunately, the data says something else. These are very niche profiles. These are very niche profiles. There are hundreds and thousands of people who are actually looking at this, you know, consulting jobs. There are hundreds and thousands of people who are actually looking at these consulting jobs. This is a niche profile. Do I have that in me to get into a BCG, Deloitte? What is it which is required? And hence, you have to move out of that curriculum which has been, you know, created for you in a 2 year. That while this is an academic theoretical knowledge has been, educating me as far as, you know, various aspects of managing, managerial functions, etc. But if in case I have to get into a consulting job, am I even preparing myself for that? Or am I just expecting that? TK, I think, you know, Mr. Kamal or somebody will bring the Deloitte to my campus and then I'll crack it. Doesn't happen that way. It hasn't happened that way. Even if Deloitte is coming to your campus or a BCG is coming to your campus, it is not going to recruit you for your qualification. Yeah, that's a prerequisite, but they're going to engage with you. They're going to strike a conversation with you, and then they're going to assess you versus the skill set, what they have versus what you bring to the table. If there is a synergy, there is a marriage. If there is no synergy,
no.
So, therefore, I just go back to the first point, that the responsibility of placing lies with you, while the environment can be created by the institution. They can bring an environment which can make you highly employable, but the responsibility lies in you. Agree? Disagree? Agree? Disagree? What else do you guys would want to? Yeah, from there. No? So, yeah, Hanji. Fantastic. That's an easy question. Okay. I'll give you a broad sense. I did mention that, you know, we are the consumer internet space. Typically, the model what we sort of adapt is, as far as Nauki space is concerned, you know, we try and do a virtual handshake between an employer and a job seeker. That's what we do. We connect people. Here, I have a requirement in terms of hiring people to, I'm looking for a job. In the space of Siksha, which is in the education, I am looking at doing higher education. We have hundreds and thousands of people. Any idea as to how many people are looking at doing MBA in India? Lakhs means? 10 lakhs? How many people appear for CAT?
2 lakhs.
How many people appear for MAT? 4 lakhs. Yes. There are 4 sessions in a MAT. So hope you guys are aware. So it is estimated to be the MBA aspirants in India with various data. So it is estimated to be about 3.7 to about 3.9 lakh people are looking at doing MBA in India, MBA PhD. And just 3%, I think 1% of them make it to IIMs. But the applications what the IIMs get is like 2 lakhs plus. That's where I think there is a, you know, gap between the expectation of a aspirant versus the institution. Just coming back to your question of what is the business model of Siksha. Because we do a virtual handshake between an institution and a higher education student, we make any and every information available for a resource. So for example, if in case you have to choose an institution for your higher education, for example, I don't know how many of you use Siksha. Fantastic. Thanks to you. Most of you. Is it to please me by any chance? You know, my penetration is less, I guess. No, higher. So, there are 2 things, you know, ma'am. I think there are 2 things, you know, as a business which you want to solve. Then I'll give you an answer. One is there are 2 identified problem statements as a business which we want to do is, one, we want to give a platform for every higher education student to explore and then take an informed decision, because 98% of them are confused in terms of what is it they should do as far as higher education is concerned, be it career. There are inputs, you've been bombarded with a lot of information, be it a newspaper, billboard, radio, papa, mama, a lot of information. But, you know, I don't know what I want. Hence, this platform is created that anything and every information, be it to do with, okay, what is a competitive exam that I should use to crack into this institution, be it IIM, NDIM, whichever institution. Being the competitive, so we have created a platform wherein the aspirant can come and engage on the platform to get any information that he can take an informed decision. So that's one problem statement what we want to address. The second problem statement is like institutions are looking at, half of them are looking at quality intake, half of them are looking at quantity of the intake. And IIM, when I was actually having a chat with Mr. Das of IIM Calcutta, he was mentioning that we are facing a threat. IIM Calcutta was mentioning this, we are facing a threat. We are having an issue in terms of having a diverse pool. He said that the students who are actually looking at IIM Cal are looking at outside India because they are going to get a diverse group. SP Global, SP Jain Global. They are looking at somebody from this country with this thought process, with this culture. So that's a problem statement. So how can we make a lot of information which is available for a student that he can take an informed decision as far as their higher education is concerned? That's one problem statement. Two, how can we help the institutions to get quality and quantity audience? That's the other problem statement what we solve. And that's where we do a marriage between the aspirants and institutions now. Is that okay with you? Does it answer your question? The business model is we generate revenue through ad sales from institutions. Anything? Anji?
My name is Abhinav Kumar.
Anji, Abhinav.
I want to ask what strategy your company follow to create value in the market?
Okay. Yeah. See, you have a seat.
Thank you, sir.
So this business was founded in 2008. The business was founded in 2008, Siksha as a business. I'll give you about a problem statement what we addressed and what is the problem statement what we are addressing as far as strategy what we are adapting as far as business is concerned. One is till about 2008, till about 2014, we were trying to get as many as institutions on board in terms of equipping the student with the content which can actually help you in terms of a decision making. 2014 onwards, what we've actually decided to do is we have identified those list of institutions where there is a maximum traction by the students. We understand the behavior of a student. A student who had accessed an NDIM would have accessed this institution, would have accessed this institution. So we understand the behavior. We understand the pattern of what informations are you looking at that in that particular institution. Is it to do with placement? Is it to do with recruitment companies? Is it to do with salary? Is it to do with the ranking? Is it to do with the faculty? Is it to do with the infrastructure? We've identified those informations. Therefore, we've enabled that on the platform that the student wants to know, anything and everything he wants to know about a particular institution. We have enriched that. That was one of the strategy, content enrichment as a strategy. Second thing is, another strategy as far as content space again is concerned is, for example, if Abhinav was confused, he had three offers from three various institutions, every institutions, but he wanted to pick up one institution out of them, to get placed, to get admitted. You wanted to know what the previous batch had experienced about NDIM. You wanted to know the alumni review of NDIM. You wanted to know those students who had passed out of alumni, passed out of NDIM last year or last before year, what salaries are they even getting? While, 0 to 2 years, 2 to 5 years, this information can equip you, enable you in terms of decision making. So that's another content, this thing which I enable you. The third thing is, I was confused while I had three options in front of me as far as my decision making is concerned. Eventually, I made it into NDIM. So your story, what we call as a My Story article in Siksha, your story enabled on Siksha will help the next aspirant who's going to come. That I was also on the same boat. I was also sort of confused. And therefore, your story of, whole narration of how you identified this institution, how did you make a choice, and how eventually you made an admission into NDIM will sort of help him to enable his decision. That's another thing which we are, which we have enabled on. That's a strategy. The differentiator could be, since because Naukri is there, since because that's the job portal, any institution's information which is available. Say for example, if in case I have to tell you what an IMA students are getting passed out, who's having a Naukri profile, on who's having a Naukri profile, I'll be able to give you a complete stats on that. So that's a clear differentiator as far as the platform is concerned. And we're still working on it in terms of enriching that too.
Sir, do you think there's a lack of skills that the market needs and between the students and the corporate sector, especially marketing? Is there any lack that students nowadays are not competing the requirement of the industry?
Okay, interesting. So if in case I have to thin slice the recruitment industry, if in case I have to thin slice the functions, you know, be it a sales function, be it a marketing function, be it a brand function, be it a, based on the functions and based on the industry, if in case I have to thin slice, then there are certain functions and there are certain organizations which has niche profiles. They are like, you know, the requirement is like probably X, but the supply is like maybe 200X. Maybe it's 200X. If in case there is a mass, availability is there, it's like 200X. Maybe the demand is like 10X, that's it. So I would say that the large gap is between the expectation of an organization versus the aspirant. But as far as the skill is concerned, because skill is something which you have to keep acquiring. I don't see a gap, but however, there are certain reports which says that somebody who is in technology-based MBA, having some idea about data science, having some idea about digital marketing, could do a better job than a normal. I don't see a skill gap. We worked with HCL. You guys know HCL is a huge recruiter as far as the IT recruitment space is concerned. They have close to 140,000 people. Now, when I was actually having a chat with a brand manager, a couple of months back, they have something called an early career program. There is a lot of noise in the market that engineers are not getting placed. You know, even the AICT report which got released in a couple of weeks back said close to about 42% have been placed. Now that's what they said, the glass is half full. You know, that's of, you know, they have projected, you know, close to about 42% of the people of, you know, I think close to about 8.7, 8, 9 lakhs sort of the people got placed. And that's not been the case, and that's a 5-year high. That's a 5-year high as per. So there is a big noise in the market saying that engineers are not getting placed. Engineers are not getting a job. They are underutilized or they are not utilized. You know, there is one gentleman who runs a skill development program in Chennai, spoke to me 6 months back. He said, Inba, you know what? You know, you work with Naukri, can you help me place 7,000 engineers? They are okay with a 5,000 rupees salary. That could sort of address the skill gap while skill development, the government is looking at, you know, enabling people as far as skill is concerned. But to come back to your question, there is a requirement and there is a supply, but the supply is for various industries and various functions. There isn't for various functions. I'm sort of missed as far as the point is concerned. I was talking about HCL. Yeah, HCL has something called an early career program, which I think most of the engineers or aspiring engineers were not aware of, or the 10 plus 2 was not aware of. And their predominant hiring happens in tier 2 and tier 3 sort of cities. Very high attrition, lacking 40,000 people, cut across the country, etc., etc., and all that. But they came up with a career program which is to do with skill hiring. They have 15 months sort of a course, wherein the student is going to get stifled for the 15 months, eventually getting enabled practical knowledge. Somebody spoke about theoretical and practical. Practically on the job for 15 months, and then get placed in HCL. So, to answer your question, there is a skill gap, but it's to do with what I want to do. You know, there is definitely a skill gap as far as certain functions are concerned. Everybody is towards CAC. And, yeah, I don't know what will happen to CAC in the future. P people have diverged through cloud computing. People are talking about data science, people are talking about blockchain, people are talking about cryptocurrencies, people are talking about various, you know, incubations and so many other things which are actually happening in this space. But yeah, I was told, I don't know how true this information was, when I was having a chat with Rewa University in Bangalore, they were mentioning that the next Olympics is going to happen where? Next Olympics.
Tokyo.
Japan. What I was told, that Japan's average age is, I think, 2 times or 2.5 times higher than India. Maybe I think their average age is, I think, 60% if I'm not. Not very sure of the data. They have a huge skill gap in terms of enabling that Olympics to happen in Japan. Hence, they have come to India, they're looking at 50,000 students to be taken to Japan to equip them on the language and on the, you know, the role which, you know, that's a gap, definitely a gap. But yeah, that's an opportunity as well. Somebody was raising their hands. I'll just leave the talk. Yeah. Hanji ma'am.
Good morning, sir. So my name is Anshi.
Hi, Anshi. Beg your pardon, sorry?
So what are the characteristics and traits that an individual must persist at the time?
Okay, please have your. Yeah, I think to partially answer your question, you know, when I was actually, you know, talking about certain prerequisites, as an organization and most of the corporates actually look forward is attitude, a positive attitude. That is very, very important. Beyond certain skill sets, beyond the groomability, beyond the thought process, beyond your educational qualification, what is very, very important for an organization is the attitude of resource. It can make you or break you in an organization. That's very important. If in case you get into skill sets, then it is specific to the function and the industry. For example, if in case we want to hire somebody in a client delivery function, then the resource should know about the nuances, the requirements, the pain points of the client. You know, for example, if in case I'm talking about from a success perspective, if in case I have to talk about NDIM, there are 2 pain points for an institution. 1 to get you here, 2 to place you. To get you here is a pain point, to place you is another pain point. If the client delivery manager of Siksha is able to identify this pain point and does the algo in terms of, okay, what type of geographies, what type of backgrounds, what type of people, demographics are people are looking at NDIM, therefore he can look at, preparing a program around it. If I can understand what are the stats which appeal to you, Anushree, right? Anushree, Abhinav, what factors influence you take a decision towards an NDIM? It could be placement, it could be infrastructure, it could be, you know, recruitment companies, it could be internship opportunities, it could be, you know, global, alliances, it could be anything which made you to come to an NDIM. Now talking very high about it, an institution should look at intensifying that, expanding that, therefore more and more people come to you. That's another pain point. The second pain point is which, you know, Kamal would sort of, how do you place the students? That's the biggest pain point of any institution. I worked with close to about 150 different TPOs. The biggest pain point is sum of, you know, that's the word they, sum of I need to place my students. That's a big challenge. So if in case as a client delivery manager to do with that particular function, if in case I'm able to address the pain point of my client, if in case I'm able to take certain processes and strategies to solve the real-time problem of my client, then that's a function which is required as far as that particular role is concerned. Skill set. But beyond all this, what is important to me as an organization and Katagala's organization corporates is attitude. That decides your attitude. Where you want to go, how you want to go. It could also give you a sense on what can unsettle you. What can settle you, what can unsettle you, beyond my ability, gentlemen.
So, what are the challenges that Shiksha.com is facing,
okay,
and who are the competitors?
Okay, that's interesting. You guys have made my job very easy, actually. They ask us certain easy questions. The challenges, at an organization level, what are we even facing is, human capital. Human capital is the biggest, despite having an operator, the biggest, you know, that would sort of address this gentleman's question, that is there a skill gap, in the market? Yes, of course. But, you know, students should know that what is it I bring to the table and all. So, the biggest challenge of Siksha, Naukri, InfoEdge, and Katakala's HCL, TCS, you know, Cognizant, etc., is that human capital. Now, if in case I can thin slice, you know, from the perspective of Siksha, if we can actually talk about, now, when we founded this business in 2008, and where we are in 2018, we have gone through different stages in the business. We were a startup. The idea was accepted. We launched. We worked. We sort of monetized the business. We kept, you know, innovating it. We kept evolving, etc. We moved. We reached a stage where we sort of scaled up. We made certain revenues out of it. We expanded the team. We brought in product. We brought in tech. We brought in system. We brought in content. We kept evolving. And today we have reached a stage where we are looking at profitability. That's the last leg of a startup. When we are looking at a profitability, what a resource did in 2008 was a business development role. You know, if in case somebody was onboarded in Siksha in 2008, his primary expectation was to go and get some development role. His revenue generation was his primary KRA. Versus in 2018, that's not the KRA. The KRA is, how can I make a business self-sufficient? There are close to about 40,000 startups in the country. How many of them are successful? Why they are not succeeding? Why few of them are not succeeding is because they have not got their math right. If in case the organization has to self-sufficient, then they have to put a profitable business model, and for which you need right human capital. So that's one problem statement of Siksha. If in case I have to talk the other side of the business, you know, there is a change in the human behavior. You know, I was just talking about this with ma'am. My cousin was graduated from an engineering, a premium engineering institution in Puerto, and then, you know, he wanted to do his higher education. Till about in his third year, fourth year, he was only talking about those institutions which was prevailing in Tamil Nadu. I happen to know that he eventually picked up an institution in Bangalore. I would have forced him to go to a Pune or a company in Delhi. There's a change in the behavior because I touched upon this, people are looking at diverse group. People are looking at the behavior of, you know, choosing institution is changing. I was talking about this, you know, with some of your professors as well, that the information which was lagging for somebody sitting in the deep pockets of a Kanpur, knowing more about a Delhi, was not there sometime back, but today, thanks to Jio, thanks to so many other things, that the information is readily available to him at a click of a button. Which means his preferences earlier was limited to one or two. Now he has a lot to choose from. He has a lot of things to choose from. So the choice what you make. Therefore, there's a change in the behavior. We are trying to put in our own, you know, ability and effort and bandwidth, with more product managers to understand how do we even capture the whole cycle of a student. That he from exploring a competitive exam to eventually taking an admission, the whole life cycle of a student. How do we even capture the whole life cycle? Do I play a significant role in terms of decision making? That's my vision. Most of you said you had explored Siksha, but I don't know how many of you would attribute the credit of choosing an institution to Siksha. I may not know. I don't know if I'm solving a problem or not. That's the biggest problem for me. That's the biggest problem statement for me. Now, what is it I have to do? I have to understand the whole behavior pattern. Understanding the change in the environment with penetration of internet, with so many other things. Half of the people are not even aware of what are the career options in front of them. They are still skewed towards engineering and, you know, NEET and JEE is still growing the most. Half of the students are not even aware of what is actually happening in the career space. You know, what are the different options that are available. And that's largely because lack of information. It was not lack of knowledge, it was lack of information. So one, the challenge what Siksha is facing is human capital. which is the major problem statement of most of the organizations in the country. The second thing is from the business perspective, that we are looking at enabling, equipping the users who are coming on the sector, that they are eventually taking a decision through us. We are working towards that direction. Yes, ma'am.
My name is Shani Sharma. So my question is, how Shiksha.com maintain a data about a review of any organization in colleges?
Okay. It's a gamed up thing. Yeah. So we have machine learning in place. So based on the hundreds and thousands of reviews which already exist in Shiksha, the choice of words, for grammatical things, abuse language, etc. There is a machine learning which is already in place, which is based on my current data, and basis which any data which is coming to me. For example, if Shiny has to write a review about NDIM, there is a review mechanism. There is a mechanism, unless your profile is tagged to Facebook, or if in case you have a LinkedIn, or you have a Naukri. Unless and until you have any of these profiles, your review will not be published on Shiksha. Two, they understand whether you're a student, or there are quite a few institutions, in the country, they just game it up. We wanted to be very sure that we are not part of it, because our vision is slightly different. Our vision is that we want to be a platform where we can enable students in terms of decision making. So there is a review mechanism, there is some machine learning in place based on my past data, that what could be. And we don't just publish the positive reviews. If in case you open an institution, you see 200 positive reviews about institution, it's not going to appeal to you. You should be that one thing which is going to spice you up, which is a factual information. Maybe the student who picked up the institution for a better faculty, a better infrastructure, was not happy about placement. He has to write there, and the institution has to accept it, and we publish it. We don't moderate it. Certain things get moderated in terms of language, but we are very, very particular that unless and until the student profile is mapped in any of these three, we don't publish it.
Sir.
Therefore, 60% is the decision ratio. Yes.
Hello, sir. My name is Mangali.
Hi.
I have a very simple question.
Ji.
When you come here for recruitment, apart from attitude, do you give more preference to someone with a job experience?
Okay. Specific to Shiksha's perspective or?
No.
Okay. I was just having a chat with Mr. Kamal, was mentioning that specific Shiksha's recruitment doesn't happen much in institutions. And that's a thought process which I've changed in the organization. Because the kind of business where we come from, the Shiksha business, because we also have functions like Jeevan Sati in the matrimony space, Naukri in the space of job, and 19x in the space of real estate, the business model is slightly different. That is to do with penetration. We can hire a lot of freshers because they bring in a lot of freshness, and then they are looking at development, they are looking at scale. Here, the business is model is slightly different. We are looking at deep diving into an institution. So it requires some amount of a seriousness. Hence, I changed hiring from freshers to laterals. And we started offering a lot of internships to people. A lot of internships to people that they could get a real-time flavor of what we are actually doing. There is this guy, from MDI. After 3 months of his job in Shiksha, 3 years back, he came and told me, sir, people are not taking me seriously. That can happen because the role demanded little complex things to handle. There were a lot of complex things to handle because it is solving a real-time problem. So to answer your question, beyond attitude, if in case somebody has some pre-MBA work ex to do with the same function, there are some qualifying marks, that person gets a preference as well. Which I posted yesterday also, saying that somebody who is in the space of technology and an IIM with some amount of experience and technology itself has a better chance of converting the job opportunity, and the chance of he taking a salary or she taking a salary is higher.
Hello, so my name is Ankit.
Hi Ankit.
I want to ask that as a recruiter, nowadays, what are the qualities which, according to you, which are lacking in today's manager while recruiting?
As a recruiter,
what are the qualities which are lacking in today's manager?
Okay, interesting. Very interesting. Thanks. Okay. So, yeah, I think, I've been managing people for almost 15, 16 years, and I've seen a lot of managers who are supposed to be the team leads, who are supposed to be managing human capital, who are supposed to manage different, everybody's different, right, in this room. I think, your thought process is different, my thought process is different. We are different people. So, the acceptance that my team members are different, their thought processes are different, their abilities are different, they should be equipped with something what they are strong at, what they are currently lagging at, and how do I, it's about, the role of a manager is to build capacity, in a resource. The resource would come across that these are five things he's good at, these are five things maybe he's lagging at. The role of the manager is to ensure that he builds capacity with these resources. I see this as a huge gap in managers.
Sir?
So therefore, they don't answer. Therefore, the manager has to understand that he is dealing with different people, different thought processes, different culture, different backgrounds, different mindsets. So there are certain strong perceptions somebody might have. It might be right from his perspective. But can you give him the big picture? Can you give him the perspective of the organization, the context of the organization? The bigger picture. Change the perception of the resource. The intense perception of the resource can actually change. Else will result in attrition. So the manager has to be very, very careful about the human capital whom he has. Two, he has to ensure that those areas where the resource is actually lagging in terms of skill or in terms of ability or in terms of attitude, can he even help in terms of building that, building capacity? That is something which I see with most of the people as a gap with recruiters as well, because they go with the close match.
So my name is Karan Kumar.
Correct.
My question is, what do you think, what are the strategies SMEs, small and medium enterprises must adopt to survive in the digital market?
SME specific to any industry or general industry? A little broad, I'll try to pick up one industry. I'll try to pick up one industry which is close to my heart, education. There are premium institutions, there are small term institutions, there are institutions that are mid level, etc. And I've had the experience of managing media, the mass medias, and having had the exposure of online, so I can talk about that. SMEs in specific digital, I would say that most of the industries and most of the more particularly, please quote me, don't quote me outside, the institutions are digitally challenged. They have a little exposure as far as digital spaces come. If in case I go, these are happening with some decent brands. I happen to meet chairperson Corpcom of a decent premium institution. I was talking about IIM Bill, which you got passed some time back. That created a lot of ruckus in the market as well. I was generally asking this person that, what do you think that this bill, IIM bill, is going to have any replication, any impact, any implication as far as your institution is concerned? This institution is a premium PGD institution. The person had very little idea. There is another person whose brand communication in the same institution. We are talking about how do you go about getting your future audience aspirants through the online medium. How do you go about tracking them? Do you have a UTM source? Do you track them through API? How do you even code this thing and all that? UTM ka matlab kya hai? What do you mean by an API? I was talking about TK, can we even get a sense of your admission data? Can we even do a VLOOKUP and then understand where the students are coming from? Where do I get this VLOOKUP software? Is VLOOKUP a software? How many of you know? Actually, that's a snow, it's coming very feeble now. Thank you so much. I would have disappointed in had it been. So, if you to answer your question, buddy, digital exposure, digital knowledge is lagging. People are digitally challenged. Hence, there are a lot of agencies who are coming into the market who are also equally challenged, because for them, digital exposure, social media is nothing but having a Twitter page, having a LinkedIn page, and having a Facebook page. That's digital exposure, that's digital. I also have a Facebook page. I've got 1,000 likes. That's not digital marketing. That's not, SEO means, yeah, I'm also seen the first, the SEO is not like, SEO is a game. I don't know how many of you know what's an SEO. Anjana.
Search engine optimization, that is it. Organic and inorganic, adding
AdWords
to this.
Fantastic. What is SEO? So what is actually happening is today, the content syndication of any platform is so gamed up. It's so gamed up. SEO is a game. I don't know if people understand what is SEO. It's gamed up. So the institutions, especially the SME sort of this thing, their understanding and awareness towards digital is very, very limited. They think that beyond a Twitter page, Facebook page, and LinkedIn page, the digital marketing is done. No, that's not the case. So if you ask me, the answer is yes. Their understanding towards digital is, because they have to understand the behavior. Who is accessing online? What is their behavior? For example, if in case an institution should know that, what is my student behavior here? And you guys are a good batch, How many students are here? 480 students. Now, 480 students' behavior is a good data point for me. It's a good base for me to understand the whole PGDM behavior. And everybody would have had a different experience, in terms of your choosing an institution. It's a good data point. I can come up with a lot of algos out of this. You actually sit on a huge data bank. 480 people's behavior is a huge data bank. That can give you a sense on what the whole behavior is all about as far as this space is concerned. But yeah, people lag as well. Knowledge is concerned. Digitally challenged is what I use. Don't quote me out, Jay. My job is to educate them. I'm putting in effort. I can only put in effort. This is my favorite Korean. Actually, take the horse to the pond. That's what institutions can do. They're taking you to the pond. Have to start whatever you want to drink water, don't drink water, is purely your choice. Any more questions? I should sort of touch on Hanjina.
So I want to ask the amount of capital you have invested in your company.
Capital? At least about 100 crores, you have pumped in more than 100 crores. About now. You are referring to financial capital, right?
Yes.
Yeah, you have pumped in more than 100 crores. We are pumping in more and more. See? Yeah. Is that answering your question?
Yes, I want to know, your company has,
market cap? 20,000 crores. Market cap of Infoedge is about 20,000 crores. We have done if you can go to Infoedge website, we are a limited company, we are limited in 2006. You have all the information to do with our financial results are already announced. 24th, we are announcing the Q1 results. You can access all the information. Since 2006 to 2018, all the financial results are there in the website.
So your company recruits for human resource management?
Haan ji, ma'am.
Sir, what is the range of the number of
requests? Beg
your pardon,
sorry?
So what
is
the number of requests
in
your company?
HR space. See, when I joined the company, HR used to be a small team. HR, for me, was, there is a recruiter, and then somebody is saying hi, please welcome to Infoedge. Today, please have a seat. Today HR is so thin sliced that I think this I got to know probably in the last appraisal cycle, that there is a comp and bend team, compensation and benefits. There is a compensation and benefit team, which I was not aware of till about last year. that's a parcel of HR business partnering is the biggest portfolio when it comes to HR. Recruitment is only a small space, which is a painful space. You know, we hire a lot of recruiters. We hire people from XLRIs, MDIs, IMs, IMPs. You know, we have hired a lot of people. But the function is so thin sliced. Recruitment is one function, compensation and benefit is another function, HRBP is another function. Attrition, you know, managing exit management is a huge function. You know, we wanted to know why a resource who was excited about onboarding, you know, InfoEdge, why does it even want to leave? You would have seen all the fancy advertisements of Naukri.com, right? You know, you should not pull yourself to the job. You know, look for the job which is, you know, you can, you know. So we also wanted to understand what is the behavior of this, you know, resource who had onboarded, had exited. So HR is sort of thin sliced. But each of the function has a different skill set, and you know, I may not know the number in terms of the recruitment, but we keep hiring people. The beg your pardon?
Pay scale.
I'll give you the information. You can go to, you know, InfoEdge, and then there is a career section. You can just figure out from there. Anjali.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah, so they told me different things like, no, this is not the right path of going. So do you think that this varied actually, or this is like, they were just, they wanted me to be there?
This will open up a, you know, Pandora of things. Have a seat. The whole soul idea of Siksha is to enable you. I didn't get your name.
Rohini.
So the whole sole idea is to enable people like Rohini to take a decision by herself. That's the vision of Siksha, be it domestic or international study. The role of consultants, you know, there are IDPs, you have Chopras, you have IEC, you have I think there is a recent acquisition of hard courses by acquired hard courses?
HT courses.
Something. I'm not sure of the name. So there are consultants, and these consultants have certain ties with certain universities in certain countries. Beyond the US, Australia, New Zealand, you know, Canada, there are certain, you know, countries. Based on how many students do you think is, you know, going out of country every year? As per MHRD, I think close to about 2.2 lakh people sort of wanting to go outside India to do their higher education. How many people do you think are coming to India to do higher education?
50,000.
Huh? She's right. 40. It ranges between 40 to 45. That's been the trend in the last 4-5 years. So where I'm even actually coming from is, these consultants have limitations because they have signed up with few institutions. Therefore, they have to make sure that you are picking one of the choices in front of you. My thought process is slightly different. I have to give you platter. I have to give you complete platter. It's not that, it's a buffet which I'm creating for you. You will have to pick and choose. That do I have to have a chicken sausage or a boiled egg which appeals to you? And what is your reason of picking them up? And that's where we are enabling content and relevant information about the particular university. Therefore, we have to give you a wide choice, and we will not insist that you should take an admission in a particular institution. But the business model of those consultants is slightly different. They have ties, and they have to make you choose in one of the options what they have. Therefore, the model is different, the thought process is different, and the process is slightly different. Is that answering your question?
Their portal, so they are giving me proper itinerary. You have to have to search a lot. I have to go through many sites, you know, like loan procedures, scholarships, and all. So I think this is a tough part.
So, you know, I think we've received this feedback. When did you explore this? Sometime back?
Yeah,
should be?
I wanted to do that.
Sometime back? Should be more than a year?
Not more than a year, before taking admission.
So, we have come up with something which is neutral constraint. We are also trying to enable students in terms of what could be the various touch points. It could be visa processing, it could be application or, you know, opening, application ending, it could be, there are various touch points for a resource who is actually looking at outside country. We have identified those touch points and we are also helping the students in terms of giving information specific to the student. So we have inbuilt a neutral counseling team now, but they will not insist on taking an admission on the 15 minutes. So because this is mostly required, because as far as domestic is concerned, I can take a decision, I can take an informed decision because I know certain things. As far as study abroad is concerned, he's still that affirmation, the conviction has to come, so therefore we have built in this.
So, are there any synergies between the business of Info-G?
Business in?
Info-H.
Info-H? Synergies from the perspective of men? I'm not getting your question, sorry.
Means do you have cooperations, like they also work in the same business like education, and so do you have any cooperation?
You are referring to Info Edge or referring to Siksha?
Info.
So Info Edge has these businesses. Beyond that, we have a business which is called firstnaukri.com. So which is again into catering the freshers. You know there is but again, largely to place them. We have a business which is firstnaukri.com. Is that what you want to know?
I asked you what.
Yeah, yeah. We are limited to this space. You know, we are a consumer internet industry and we are limited to this space. Interesting. Does the objective of having this session is addressing certain pain points of you? Is your anxiety levels are coming down or is it anxiety levels are increasing? Whatever questions do you have, is it even, you know, because to ask a question, you know, somebody should have some courage to stand up and ask a question, but you know, the answer might not really appeal to you. Hence I want to understand, am I even addressing certain pain points of you, real-time pain points of you that can actually enable you to, you know, equip yourself? That's where I'm even coming from. Any questions? Any more questions?
So I
have one question.
So that I'm sure it's going to help all of them.
Yeah.
So they have 1.5 year to sit for a placement process.
Yeah.
2019, September onwards, they will
sit. D-Day.
So what do I really need to work on? And, you know, apart from classes, apart from exactly knowledge, what do they really need to work on to be ready for a recruiter?
Fantastic.
So that they can sail through that process.
So, one, the first step towards this is like, understand you, understand what you want. Jot down those points in terms of which industry, which function you would want to prefer. You know, you can have a, you know, chat with your placement cell in terms of what's been the recruitment companies which are coming to your campuses. What's been the skill set which has been required, what type of recruitment actually happens, what type of questions asked. You know, what are the functions has been, you know, hired from here, etc., etc. And, you know, make a wish list from that, identify those organizations or identify your own set of organizations, identify those skill set which is required and start preparing yourself beyond the 6 hours, 8 hours of your education. Spend that time in terms of enabling you, because it is the qualification will enable you to walk you into the interview room. Cracking it is with you. So therefore, to answer, you know, ma'am's question, beyond you know, the academic curriculum, can you identify what is who are you, what do you want, identify those organizations, those skill sets, those functions which you think you'll be able to value at, and then start equipping yourself. If in case somebody says that I would want to get in the space of data science, e-commerce, a lot of e-commerce companies are coming to hire. a lot of people would want to know about digital marketing, because you know this gentleman was asking what is the understanding of SMEs towards digital. The knowledge is poor. If in case my knowledge is poor, then how can I even value it? Can I enable myself? 6 months certification program from Google is not going to give you digital marketing knowledge. Let's be very realistic about it. You know, I have a 3 month certification course from Google on digital marketing, social media marketing, so I'll become a digital marketer. No. So enabling yourself, you know, and third important thing is when you go for interns, pick up those organizations, pick up those, you know, functions which will help you to crack the interview. I see a lot of people making a mistake there. They pick up institutions just to while away time. 4 or 5 people together, spend 2-3 years, have fun time, 2-3 years there, 2-3 months there, you know, having chai, you know, some, you know, fun, etc., etc., and then while away time. So, can you even pick up those organizations which can enable you, which can give you a real time flavor of what you want to do in a real time scenario? So one is identifying who you are, what you want, 3, what skill sets you bring to the table versus what is being asked, what will be asked. Some amount of soft skills in terms of attitude, groomability, thought process, knowing about, for example, if in case you are appearing for an interview with InfoEdge, and just giving an example, if in case you are going to get into the interview room with the recruiter, you should know about in and out of the organization as far as InfoEdge is concerned, be it their press release, be it the media information, be it the financial results, be it the business models, be it the investee companies, be it anything, you should be thorough about the organization. You should be able to question the recruiter, right questions. I've heard a lot of questions, kitna salary, kitna deti hai, that's what, the Maruti thing, JD, all that is fine, but kitna deti hai, what is the salary, what do you offer? What is the career path which you can give me? These are right questions. But set the context. Set the context. Understand, is this the organization? Is this the skill set which has been asked? And this is what I possess. Therefore, I see a marriage. Therefore, I see a synergy. Then, you know, equip yourself in that space as far as skill set is concerned. Whichever organization you are appearing for an interview, know about the organization thoroughly. That's very, very important. Therefore, one is knowing you, what you are, what you want. Then, you know, beyond the skill sets what you have, what will be the skill set which will help you in terms of cracking a real-time interview? It could be a digital function, it could be a data science function, it could be a sales function, it could be a marketing function, it could be a function which is, you know, completely different from, you know, you want to become a banker, you want to become an investment banker. Then put your next 1.5 years of effort in terms of equipping yourself with those knowledge which will help you to build your thought process. You should be able to engage with the interviewer with the thought process which is your 1.5 years of 2 years of hard work. That should clearly reflect. Your freshness has to reflect. Your energy level has to reflect. Your keenness has to reflect in the conversation with the recruiter. And then when you get the opportunity, when you get the real opportunity, hold it with 2 hands. Give your best. There could be a lot of distractions which can come your way. There could be a lot of distractions which can come your way. Anything can actually sort of unsettle you, but hold on to it. Hold on to it for some time. Learning is very, very important in learning. This is what I tell a lot of institutions, because PGTM students slightly have a different expectation. Put your learning first. Put learning, you know, give priority to learning first. Earning will automatically come to you. Give priority to learning, and therefore equip yourself in next 1.5 years in terms of which function, which skill set, which organization, therefore enabling you towards that, this thing will be something which is that anything else you guys? Anji ma'am.
Hypothetical data.
are 52,000 to 52,000 a month. So there is not much difference in the amount. I mean, I'm talking about the in terms of monetary terms. So why MBA then? I mean, he asked me the question and I didn't have a proper reply to the answer. And your reply, because you are from Diksha.com and you have a data behind this.
Real-time problem, huh? Real-time problem. I think if in case I answer this, I think it should answer a lot of things. See, it's very, very important. Education is very, very important. There are no two ways about it. Education is your foundation. Why do you guys even get into institutions? Why do you get trained for 2 years, etc.? The environment, the learning, the processes, the curriculum is very, very important, and this people might term it this as theoretical, it might not have, you know, practical, etc. That is fine. But for you to move the ladder, to crack a job, to crack an interview, to get into a job, to get into a function, to get into an organization, you might have all the skills to crack it. For you to move the ladder, for you to handle critical positions, you have to have that education. So, to answer your question, I can get a 25,000 rupees job or I can get a 50,000 rupees job with a graduation, with a post-graduation. But it will matter at 5 years from now, 10 years from now, when you are middle of your career, when you are in a peak of your career, your education will matter a lot. The kind of roles which are coming to you, the kind of response which are coming to you, will purely depend upon your education matter. Purely. Now I'm telling with a lot of confidence. This is very important. Ajina. Yeah. Any more questions? Otherwise we'll call it a day. Was that useful to you guys?
Yes, sir.
Any feedbacks? Which I could have done, which I have not done. Any feedbacks? Which I could have touched upon, which could have been some value to you from a perspective, which you wanted. I don't know what was the objective, what you all had. I definitely didn't want to bore you with the presentation. I did not want to do that. Anything else which you guys, any feedbacks? Yeah, somebody gave me a rating. Somebody already gave me a rating. Overall good. Thank you so much, guys.